Hello friends, welcome back to my channel. So in today's video we will see how we can generate carbon-carbon double bond using fragmentation reactions, right? And fragmentation reactions are the reaction in which a carbon-carbon bond will break and we will have to generate a new carbon-carbon double bond. So what is the important point about this fragmentation reaction? That the carbon leaving group bond and carbon-carbon bond which is going to break, these two bonds should be anti-periplanar to each other. What is the meaning of this point? I will tell you here. We have also taken these three examples in Claydon book summary, but now you can again understand it. That first we have to draw this decalene structure into chair form, and we have to find out that which type of decalene it is. So this is a trans decalene, so we can draw it like this. Right, and suppose this OH is at axial position, then at third position, at tosylate group, it is trans to this OH, and we know that at 1,3 position, trans group means they will be axial equatorial to each other. If one group is axially placed, other will go equatorial. Right, so now you can understand that when I will use this base, this bond will break. This H will be removed, so this bond will break, and this tosylate will be removed. So you can see that there is fragmentation of this carbon-carbon double bond. It is going to fragment. Fragment means break. So when it will break, this will form a new double bond at this position, and this leaving group will be removed. So the carbon leaving group bond, and this bond, these two bonds should be anti-periplanar, and this is true for this case because these two are anti-periplanar, so this bond can break and we will get a new double bond at this position, right? So you can also write it like this. So I will get a double bond at this position, and here I have a carbonyl group. So this is first carbon, this is second, third, fourth, fifth and sixth, and this is the E-alkene. You can see that this is E-alkene. So what will be the structure? This is suppose my carbon number 1 on which this carbonyl group is placed, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and 6. So I can place this double bond here. It is also E in nature, right? So using the starting material, using the stereochemistry of the starting material, you can find out the stereochemistry of your final product. If you are following correctly the fragmentation process, you can easily find out the stereochemistry of your final product, right? Next we will take one more example. This is a cis decalene. So how I can draw cis decalene, right? So if one bond is axially placed, other will go equatorial, right? So it will have a structure like this. Now my OH is at ring junction and it is axially placed like this. So this tosylate, which is again trans to this OH, should go equatorial, 1, 2, 3, and this is the equatorial position. So when I will fragment this bond will shift and tosylate will be removed. So that this leaving group and this carbon-carbon bond is again anti-periplanar to each other, so I can break this bond. And when I will break this bond, I will get a new double bond at this position. It is also E-alkene. If you can see that, it is also a E-alkene, right? Means you will get the same type of product here. But if I have other type of cis decalene, I will get a different diastereomer. I can also write down this cis decalene in another different way. So another possibility is I can write down this ring like this, right? And now one group is going axial, other one will go equatorial. So this OH is in equatorial direction, so it should be trans to tosylate, means tosylate will go equatorial, 1, 2, 3. This tosylate will go like this. Now if I will break this bond will shift here and tosylate will be removed. So I have a double bond at this position, and now you can see that this double bond is cis in nature, right? It is like this, or you can draw it, it is at this position. If you will draw it like this, you will get double bond at this position, because only this position is cis double bond position, and then in that case your carbonyl group will shift to this carbon, right? Because it is at 5th 6th position, 5 and 6 carbon atom of this carbonyl. With respect to this carbonyl, that this double bond should be placed. So you will get cis alkene in this case. So you can get two different type of thioisomer if you are using two different type of thioisomers of starting material, right? Now let's see this a case. Now again I have trans decalene, so I can write down it like this. So OH will go axially, and at equatorial position I have, sorry, I now I have OH and this tosylate group cis to each other. Cis to each other means at 1,3 position, if it is axial, then it will also go axial, right? So if you can see that when I will break this bond will break and tosylate will be removed. But this bond and this bond are antiperiplanar to each other? No, they are not antiperiplanar, so they cannot break. So it will not give me desired product in efficient amount, right? Let's see next example. So we have seen that we can use tosylate as a leaving group in different type of decalene compounds to show fragmentation reaction. So other compounds can also show fragmentation, other reactions can show can also show fragmentation reaction. This time we are using a borane, right, B2H6, and we have a double bond here. So first we have to do syn addition of this borane to this double bond, because we know that it is syn addition. So suppose I am writing down this part of this structure only in chair form, it is like this, right? And this position is suppose 1, this is 2, this is 3, this is 4, and this is 5. So at first carbon I have 2 methyl group, it is like this. At third position I have this mesylate group, so it will preferentially go equatorial in position like this. Then at fourth position I have again methyl, which is cis to this mesylate group. At 1,2 position, groups attached cis to each other means they will go axial equatorial or equatorial axial. If this mesylate is equatorial, then methyl group will go axial in direction, right? Next we have carbon number 5, this one, and to this carbon we have to attach another part of this ring, right? So we have two options, that we can attach this ring in trans way or we can attach in cis way. So first we will try to attach in trans, right? We will get this type of structure. Now we have a double bond at this position. So when we have this double bond here, now we have to do syn addition of this B2H6 to this double bond, and we know that H from this B2H6 will attach from the more hindered carbon, and the rest part will go to the less hindered carbon atom. And syn addition means if one will go axial, other will go equatorial. So we will attach proton to this one. So equatorial position is already occupied, so we will have to place proton in axial direction. Now this B2H6 will go equatorially, right? If I am using a base in this reaction, so it will attack on this boron, this bond will shift here, this will shift here, and this mesylate will be removed. So if you can see that there is only fragmentation of this bond will be removed, this is fragmented, and this bond and this carbon leaving group bond are antiperiplanar to each other, so they can break easily, right? So when it will break, I will get a new double bond at this position, and when I will get a new double bond at this position, you can see that this alkene is e-alkene in nature, because one bond is going downward direction, other is going upward direction, so it is e in nature, right? So I will get a e-alkene in this case. Let's take another possibility. Again I will draw first ring, then similar to previous one I will again attach the group in same way. Now this time we want to place this ring in cis way like this. So I have a double bond at this position in the starting, So proton will go axially because equatorial position is already occupied. So it will go axially, and this rest part of this B2H6 will go equatorially like this. Now OH will attack again on this one. This bond will shift here. This bond will break and mesylate will be removed. So again the fragmentation is possible because these two bonds are antiperiplanar to each other. So again fragmentation reaction is possible. And this time we will get a new double bond at this position. And this double bond is also E in nature. Right? This one is also E. This is also E. We have one more double bond at this position. And this double bond is also E in nature. Similarly, this one is also E in nature. So we will get same type of product using two diastereomers. So if you number this rings, then you can easily identify the position of these double bonds. Right? You will get this product. Both alkenes are E in nature. Then we will take fragmentation of hydrazones of alpha beta epoxy ketones. So this portion is very very important because we are going to fragment hydrazones of alpha beta epoxy ketone. In next few slides we will see different type of hydrazones, and whenever we are using different type of hydrazones we will get different name reactions. So you have to be careful about starting material as well as about the base used. In this particular case you have to be careful about the starting material used. In this case we are using alpha beta epoxy ketone. Then this reaction is known as Eschen-Moser fragmentation, right? So how we can do this reaction? First we have to use this tosyl hydrazine, and we have a ketone, so hydrazone will be formed. Now what about the rest part of this hydrazone? This will go to the less hindered side, right? This part of the ring is less hindered. If I will place this part here, then it will be hindered structure. In next step I am using a base, so this base will remove this proton. When it will be removed, I will get a negative charge here. So this negative charge will shift here. In next step this bond will shift and epoxide ring will open, right? This bond will shift, this negative charge will shift here, this bond will shift here, this will shift here to form nitrogen, and this group will be removed. So what we will get here, this is triple bond, so we should draw a straight line, right? This will be final product. Next we will take a different type of hydrazone, and we will going to synthesize alkenes from these hydrazones, and this time these reactions have different names. And how you can identify their names, I will tell you. In this case you can use tosyl hydrazones, or you can use any other aryl sulfonyl hydrazone, right? Then you can have here a milder base for this reaction. Mild base like sodium methoxide and potassium hydride. So whenever you have these type of conditions, this reaction is called as Bamford-Stevens reaction. So because we are using a mild base here, so this base will remove only this hydrogen which is more acidic. We have two acidic protons here, this one as well as at this position attached to alpha carbon atom of this imi, this hydrazone, right? But we have here only a milder base, so it will remove more acidic proton first, right? So we will get this one. In next step, what we have to do, always remember that whenever you have tosyl hydrazone or any other sulfonyl hydrazone, you have to remove this part first. So how this is possible? If you will give a lone pair of electron to this bond, this will be removed. So I will get a new double bond at this position, and here I have positive charge. In next step, this nitrogen will be removed and we have carbene here, right? So this carbene can show proton abstraction and it can be converted into alkene like this. So how we can get this type of alkene, we will see this example. So in this case again we are using a mild base, we have tosyl hydrazone, it means it is Bamford-Stevenson reaction. So first we have to remove this proton only. We can write down this part as R, right? In next step, what will happen? It will give its lone pair of electron to this bond, and this tosylate will be removed like this. Then we have to generate a carbene here. So I am directly showing it here that I will get a carbene at this point. Then proton abstraction can take place from this carbon, or it can take place from this one. But we know that carbon double bond carbon at this position is not so much stable as compared to this one. So this will not be possible. We have to place a double bond at this position only. Right, this will be final product. Then this is, we have seen here Bamford-Stevenson reaction. This time we are using again tosyl hydrazone, or we can use any other aryl sulfonyl hydrazone, but we have here stronger base. Stronger base means whenever you see butyl lithium, alkyl lithium, any other alkyl lithium, or you can see that LDA is given in reaction mixture, then it is your Shapiro reaction. Right, so in Shapiro reaction, generally two or more than two equivalents of alkyl lithium or LDAs are used, but it is also possible that they will give you two type of bases. Like in first step, they will give you a milder base, then they can give you butyl lithium. Then you will have to identify that it is also Shapiro reaction, because in that case we have two bases, two equivalents of bases, so we have to remove two protons, one this one and another from this position. So when you remove from this position, you will get a negative charge here, and from this position you will get a negative charge here. Right, so this is your dianion. And next step is, when you have this dianion, next step is this bond will shift here, this will shift here, and this tosylate group will be, sorry, this aryl sulfonyl will be removed, because I have told you that always remember that you have to first remove this sulfonyl group, because it is very good leaving group, they can easily leave the compound. Right, in next step, this negative charge will shift here, it will shift on this carbon, we have a negative charge on this carbon, it will combine with lithium from this alkyl lithium or from LDA, and it will give you lithium here. Then if you use a electrophile, then this electrophile will occupy this position of lithium like this. Right, so in this reaction, what is the important point? Mechanism is very easy and we all know about the mechanism, but important point is this removal of proton from this carbon, this second deprotonation is from the carbon which is syn to this group. This second deprotonation from carbon which is syn to this SARSO2N- group, like this one, right? And it will always from the less, it will, it is all, most of the time it is from less hindered carbon. You can also see this point from another way, that when you will generate a hydrazone from ketone, right? So this hydrazone will always try to occupy the position which is less hindered. What I mean, that if you have a ketone here and you will generate, suppose you can take this example, then you will easily understand it, that in this case I have this example. So in the starting, suppose I have a ketone like this, then I will use this tosyl hydrazine and I have to generate a tosyl hydrazone. So this tosyl hydrazone can occupy, can be placed in this position, in that direction, in the direction of this phenyl ring, or it can go in the direction which is shown here. So you know that it is a bulkier group and it always try to occupy the place which is less hindered. To be stable, it occupy the space place which is less hindered, right? So it will go in the direction of less hindered carbon, and obviously when it will go in the less hindered in the direction of less hindered carbon, it will remove proton from the carbon which is syn to this, which is less hindered. So this point is very obvious. If you understand this one, this is sufficient. And you know that whenever you generate this hydrazone, it will occupy the place which is less hindered, right? When I will use this butyl lithium, I have to remove a proton from this position and from this position. So first I will get a negative charge here, and I will get a negative charge here also. Then rest part of the reaction is very easy, right? Then this bond will shift here, this will shift here, and it will take D from the deuterium. We have used deuterium here, so it will take it from here, and we will get this one is final compound, right? Next we will take one more example based on the same reactions, Shapiro reaction, but this example is very very interesting, and I think it is very important also, because it is slightly different, and slightly different things are always asked in NET and GATE exam, so it is very important, right? So in this reaction, first they have given us butyl lithium at very low temperature, right? Then I have this halide, then again butyl lithium is given but slightly higher temperature, and then iodine is used. So we have two important things here: the use of temperature, how we will use this temperature, and we have a different type of aryl group attached here. Why we are using this one, we will also discuss that, but first we will take temperature. So when we use this butyl lithium, we know that we have to generate two anions, means dianion. One is generated from this point, I am writing it as AR, and one is at this position, right? We have two dianion, and at this low temperature, this dianion is stable, means it will react only from this carbon. This part will remain as such, means this negative charge will attack on this carbon, I will be removed. So when it will react with this one, I will get this compound, right? So this is the use of this low temperature condition, that we can do this reaction like this. In next step, I am again using butyl lithium, but this time temperature is slightly higher. So again a dianion is created, one is already present, it will be created at this point, right? So now the reaction will take place in the way it is take place usually, that this bond will shift, this charge will shift here, this will shift here, and this group will be removed. We have this one. In next step, this charge will again shift, and this carbon has negative charge, will attack on I, and we will get I attached here. So we have understand how we can use this temperature. Now next point is that why we have used this 2,4,6 triisopropyl sulfonyl hydrazone. It is also called as TRISIL. Why we have used this? Because if you can see that in this group, all the ortho positions, these positions are occupied by this isopropyl group. So in this case, we can avoid ortholithiation, which can be another side reaction when we are using this type of hydrazones with this alkyl lithium. Then ortholithiation can also be possible, because sulfur has lone pair of electron, and it can show or attachment of groups, attachment of electrophiles at ortho position. So we will get different product than what we desire, right? So to avoid the side reactions of ortholithiation type of reaction, we are using this TRISIL group here. Next we will take another example based on the same type of reaction. The same thing is given here, that tertiary butyl lithium is used, and temperature is varied from low to slightly higher. So we will see directly the mechanism of this, that first we will get negative charge here at this position and at this position. So we will get a negative charge here, and in next step, this bond, this negative charge will shift here, this bond will shift here, and TRISIL will be removed, right? And in next step, this charge will come back, it will shift on this carbon. Now this carbon having negative charge will attack on this carbon, and this bond will shift like this. So what you will get here, you will get a 5 membered ring preferentially here. This is showing that this compound is preferentially 5 membered ring. I have read the research paper based on this reaction also. They have shown that formation of 5 membered ring is more preferential than 6 membered ring, and they found in an NMR studies that proportion of such type of compounds is much higher, right? So it gives us preferentially 5 membered ring. Next question comes, that what will be the attachment site of this H and this carbon. So it is mostly in most of the in higher amount we will get cis type of attachment. Why this is possible? They explained this using two approaches, that when we draw its chair form, then two type of attachment of this part is possible. This part is possible. One possibility is this carbon-carbon bond, this one, and this lithium are coplanar to each other. This is called coplanar approach. And using this coplanar approach, they give cis type of product. Another possibility is this perpendicular type of product. And if this perpendicular type of approach is used, then you will get trans attachment of these groups. And this is less stable. This is less stable form. So the product is from coplanar approach. So this type of product is in higher amount. Right. Next, we will take very interesting example, and I think it is very useful also to understand the mechanism. So in this case, we are using NaBH4 in acetic acid along with this hydrazone, right? So first we will see the mechanism, then we will come to this example. So we know that NaBH4 will do the reduction of this carbon double bond nitrogen first, right? So when we will do its reduction, hydrogen will attach, one hydrogen will attach here and one will attach like this, right? Then next step is this bond will break and this group, tosyl group, will be removed. So when it will be removed, we will get this type of product, right? Now we have to align this bonds in different way to get a different type of reaction, that I can also write down it like this. And it can show 1,5 sigma tropic shift of this hydrogen. It will shift like this. And when it will shift like this, I will get this double bond at this position. The position of double bond is shifted from this one to this one. Right. So if you understand this mechanism, you can easily do this one. So this time I have NaBD4, deuterated sodium borohydride. So what should I do? That I can write down this R, this part of the ring as R, and when I will use this deuterated NaBH4, then I have to place this D here and one D at this position. Next step is this bond will break and tosylate will be removed. So what I will get here, I can write down this part like this to show 1,5 sigma tropic shift of hydrogen, right? In next step, it will show this shift. So we will get this product, right? So this one is easy, that simply we are using NaBD4 in place of NaBH4. But if you have deuterated acetic acid, then exchange of hydrogen from NH is to ND is much faster than rest part of this mechanism. Means we have one NH group here, this nitrogen is attached with this hydrogen, so this acetic acid will first remove this hydrogen and deuterium will be placed here. Means first step is that I will get this one. Next step is I am using this NaBH4, so it will do reduction of this part like this. Next step is this bond will break, this tosyl group will be removed. Sorry, I have D here this time, and here I have H. So it will show sigma trophic shift, and in the product I will get H here and D here, right? So this product is different than this one. So this is very interesting, that you have to simply remember that when you have deuterated acetic acid, then you have to do exchange of proton attached with nitrogen first with deuterium, then you will do rest part of this mechanism. So this one is very, very important and very interesting example. So I will finish today's video here. In next part, we will cover rest part of this chapter also. If you like my videos, please share my videos with your friends and please hit the like button. Thank you so much for watching.